for every single person that has helped by serving, by praying, and by giving. Thank you. Let me ask you a question. Does the next generation need a place they can learn about Jesus in a fun but clear way? What's the answer? Yes. Yeah, the next generation needs that. So thank you for being a church that is committed to that and walking in that. Well, Shoreline Church, you hear us talk about, and we're going to continue talking about, what does it mean to grow in our faith? How do I know I'm actually maturing and going forward and growing as a follower of Jesus Christ? And we talk about seven markers of maturity, seven biblical teachings that say this is a big part of what it means to grow in our faith. And you'll see those up behind me here. Bible engagement, we're growing in the Word of God, we're knowing it, we're living it, we're following it. Passionate prayers become part of our hearts and our lives. Wholehearted worship, we worship and celebrate God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Humble service, we use our hands and our hearts to serve people in need and share with our mouths the story of Jesus. Joyful generosity, we live with open hands and open hearts to share what God gives. Consistent community, we connect with other Christians and love other believers. And organic outreach, we shine the light, like a lighthouse, the light of Jesus. In our workplace, at our school, in our neighborhoods, wherever we go. All those are part of this journey of becoming more like Jesus, of growing in spiritual maturity. But one of those jumps out for many people as one that some people say, well, why do we need to talk about that? One of those topics, as a pastor, when I talk about it, I'll have people say, why do you got to talk about that? What's the big deal with that? One of those topics is not like the others. If you don't remember Sesame Street, right? And for some people, one of those is like, Pastor, don't talk about those. Well, that's what I'm talking about today. Can I get an amen? Amen. Anybody know which one it is? Joyful generosity. Good, you're a clever bunch. We're talking about true riches. And God wants us to experience true riches for now and for eternity. So we're going to talk about understanding and embracing the mind of God. Because if we think like God wants us to think, it will impact how we live our lives. I want to read a passage. I'm going to ask you to not open your Bibles for this one. We're going to have a number of passages, and I'll come back to this one later. But just listen to these words of Jesus. He's talking to a mass of people, some believers, some not believers, some new believers. He's talking to people that are some poor, some are rich, but it's called the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus says these things. Just listen and imagine you are on that hillside hearing Jesus, God in human flesh, speaking these words. Because Jesus said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And a couple verses later, he says this: "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you'll be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." That's the words of Jesus to a massive group of people from different walks of life. And when Jesus says you cannot serve both God and money, he doesn't say you cannot have both God and money. I mean, you can be a Christian and have material goods. That's not the point. He's saying you can't serve both. One of those two things will get your allegiance. If money is your primary love, it will own your heart, it will own your life, and you can't be held by God the way he wants to hold you. And if God has you, then money won't. But our lives and our hearts aren't big enough to have two masters when it comes to God and money. It's a challenging topic. It's one that some pastors avoid. It's one that some people, when they listen, don't want to hear. I remember my first church I pastored, I was in my 20s, young pastor, just out of seminary. And I preached about generosity. I preached about giving. And an older gentleman came up to me after the service, and he's kind of making a little joke. He says, "You know, pastor, you know, whenever a pastor talks about finances and money and stuff," he says, "I don't know what happens, but my hearing aid, the battery runs out." And he gets a big laugh. And I just thought, that's too bad. Because we're talking about something that's really important. Because how we think and how we view things shapes our lives and shapes our worlds. And the Bible addresses lots of topics. I'm going to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you, did you know that there, and I'm going to talk about some different numbers of Bible passages about different topics. In your mind, how many times do you think the Bible talks about prayer? In the whole Bible, 66 books of the Bible. Here's the answer. Prayer comes up about 500 times. Prayer is a big deal to God. So prayer comes up about 500 times. How many times do you think faith comes up in the Bible? Faith. growing in faith, you know, having a strong faith, faith in Jesus. About 500 times, faith comes up. Now, how many verses do you think there are about money, material goods, generosity, greed, the opposite of generosity, and how we think and see our resources and how we use them? Just in your mind, how many passages about that? Here's the answer. Over 2,000. So technically, I should talk four times more about money than I do about prayer. But I don't. But when people go, why do you got to talk about that? Because the Bible's filled with it. As a matter of fact, 40% of the stories Jesus told, the parables, 40% are about money. And his illustrations about money, material goods, 40%, almost half of Jesus' stories had to do with resources. This matters to God because it's such a huge part of our lives. Here's a question. I wonder if how we think about money matters to God and matters to us. I wonder if our mindset, our philosophy, our worldview, and our thinking matters to God. Here's a great quote from two of the top Christian scholars of our generation, J.P. Moreland and William Lane Craig. Both are apologists, defend the Christian faith, brilliant scholars. In a book they wrote together, they say this: make no mistake about it, ideas matter. The ideas one really believes largely determine the kind of person one becomes. Everyone has a philosophy of life. That is not optional. We have a way we view the world. What is optional and thus of extreme importance is the adequacy of one's philosophy of life. Because what we think shapes what we do in every area of life, big and small. Let me give you just an ordinary one that everyone can relate with. Okay, there are some people that would say this: I love dogs. Dogs are wonderful and amazing. Dogs are like family to me. I love dogs like I love people, maybe sometimes. You said it, not me. Okay, and so some of you, and if that's you, you won't hear another word I say. You're just looking at the dogs going, dogs, 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 dogs. But some, there's people who love dogs. Here's a question for you. If someone loves dogs, will that impact how they feed their dogs? Absolutely. They're going to want to get the best food. They're going to pick healthy dog food, and just, you know, and that matters to them. Will it impact how they care for their dog in times of need? If they love, if someone doesn't like dogs, doesn't care about dogs, their response, it got really, really sick, but you can get another one. Some of you are like, no, you can't say that. That's the person who's not into the dog thing, right? But I was talking with a person one time, and this person was saying, oh man, we're really tight financially. We have had all these doctor's bills and medical bills and surgery bills. And I said, well, who's sick? I'm thinking their kid or their grandkid. Who's sick? And it was their dog. Now, a non-dog person would say, what? But a dog person goes, of course. Is everybody following me? They're saying, you're walking on the edge here, man. You can talk about giving, but watch when you talk about dogs. No, but the point is, the mindset impacts, a person's mindset about dogs impacts how they talk about dogs, how often they talk about dogs. It impacts how many pictures are in their phone of their dog or dogs, right? I mean, and so here's the point. And this goes both ways. How we think about something clearly impacts how we live, what we do. And it goes the opposite. You can watch how someone behaves and lives, and you can tell me how they think about something. You can watch a person say, they don't really care about dogs. You can watch another person go, oh, they love dogs. So how we think and our worldview and our mindset impacts our behavior, and our behavior reveals and shows our mindset. And the same is true when it comes to money, to resources. There's a way of thinking that will impact how we live. And God cares about this very, very much. Now, I want to give a special thanks to two scholars. They're actually scholars that studied at Harvard Business School. You'll see up here, they wrote a book called God and Money. And I have about 12 books on my bookshelves in my study on money and finances and the Christian faith. I took all of these out about 2 months ago and began going through them as I was getting ready for this little two-week series this week and next week. But as I started to study, and this one really jumped out at me. I read this book, and it was so helpful. And so what I want to share with you is this, and I always give credit. Solomon said in the Old Testament, there's nothing new under the sun. There's nothing new. Well, I'm going to share some things that I borrowed from them. They would be happy that I did. They wrote this book so pastors would actually share this with their congregation. So if you buy that book, which we have some in our bookstore, if you want to go deeper and buy that book, you're going to read some stuff, and you're going to go, hey, Pastor Kevin got that from these guys. So I'm telling you right now, hey, Pastor Kevin got that from these guys. Okay, I'm telling you, and that's what a good pastor does, is you learn from people way smarter than you and who've done years of research on things. So these guys are brilliant guys. This book's been very helpful, so you can pick up a copy if you want to. But what one of the things they address is our mindset, our philosophy, our way of thinking shapes our lives. And really, in every area, but particularly we're going to talk today about how we view finances. So let me give you some possible philosophies of money, ways of thinking. And just in your mind, ask yourself the question, what will this person's life look like? If their thinking impacts their behavior, how might their lives be shaped? So here's one. Somebody says, my philosophy of money and material stuff is this. I spend it the moment I get it, and I spend as much as possible on me. Okay, so somebody's mindset and behavior is, when I get money, it's my money, it's for me, and when I get it, I spend it immediately. Will that impact their lifestyle? Every day, right? Here's another philosophy. My philosophy of money and material stuff. I spend it before I get it. Yeah. I have gotten used to living in debt, and I don't think I will ever get out of debt. If someone thinks that way, will that impact how they live their life? Yeah. Oh, man, I'm fine with being in debt. Got a new credit card. Hooray, more money. You know, it's not thinking about the 12% interest or 16%, you know, that'll affect their lives. Here's another one. My philosophy of money and material stuff. I am a saver, and I do all I can to put away every dollar I can for the future. If someone's mindset is money is to be saved for the future, will that impact their normal daily life? Absolutely. Different way of living, right? Here's one more. My philosophy of money and material stuff. I don't even think about it because someone will take care of me. Family, friends, the church, government, someone, anyone. But if the mindset is, I don't worry about it because someone's taking care of me, will that impact how they live their life, right? The way we think shapes how we live. And God has things to say about how we live. God has a philosophy, a way of thinking for his children when it comes to money. If you're a follower of Jesus and you want to live like Jesus and become more like Jesus, you have to look and say, okay, what does Jesus have to say about material things? Is there a way he wants us to live? And Jesus talks about three different kind of approaches to money. More than that, but three kind of main categories. I'm going to look at those today. The three kind of categories are ways of thinking about material goods that shape how we live in relationship to what God puts in our care. So I'm going to introduce you to three kinds of people, and I'm going to invite you to look and actually humbly ask the question. Don't be like the old guy who said, oh, my hearing aid ran out or I stopped listening. I'm going to ask you to really listen between you and Jesus and say, what is my mindset towards material things? What's my outlook? And is there a way that needs to be adjusted to bring me more in line with what Jesus wants for me? I will tell you that these three people I'm going to introduce to you, three kinds of people, I've been all three, and I'm still a mixture of all three. It's not really clean cut. I'll share at the end kind of what my journey has been. But I'm learning to, I think, get my thinking to be in line with God's thinking when it comes to material things. But here's three different kinds of people. Meeting person number one. This person we're going to call the spender. The spender. And here's the outlook. I might save some. I might give a little bit. But the driving force of my life is enjoying each day, consuming what I like, and spending what I earn. So my motto is, live it up. My motto is, say it with me, live it up. That wasn't very heartfelt. My motto is, 1, 2, 3, live it up. And that, you know, I think for all of us, there's moments and times in our lives where that's, you know, I get something, I want to do something with it. This is for me, I'm going to do something. So that's the motto, live it up. And a person who has this, a spender, invest mostly in today. Their investment is, what can I experience right now? What can I experience today? And Jesus spoke to people who money kind of had a hold of them and was sort of so entrenched in their life that it had become their God, it had become the most important things to them, and he talked about how it impacted faith. As a matter of fact, in Matthew chapter 13, Jesus tells a story about a farmer who goes out and he scatters seed all over the place. He scatters seed on the road and on hard-packed soil, and he scatters seed in the weeds, and he scatters it in good soil. He's just scattering seed, hoping he gets a harvest. And some of the seed gets, you know, picked up by birds, and some of it grows really huge and big, but one bunch of the seed lands in the weeds. And here's how Jesus describes it. He says, the seed falling among the thorns, the weeds, refers to someone who hears the word, the heart of a person who hears God's word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. Jesus says, it's possible for our love of stuff and stuff being just so immediate and part of our lives that it's a consuming force of our lives, that it can actually squish out and kill faith and keep people from coming to faith. Jesus says, be careful that you might have money, but that money doesn't have you, right? Be careful. Be wise about that. And he warns us. Now, is there anything wrong with spending money? The answer is no. We all have expenses and bills, and we all can have some fun with life. So the point Jesus is not making is don't spend money, but the spender is the person whose consuming passion and driving force is all the money I get is for me, and I'm going to spend it as fast as I can. And that kind of thinking leads to a certain kind of a lifestyle. So how do I know if I'm kind of in a spender, or how do I know if that's kind of what's shaping my heart and shaping my thinking and shaping my life? You might be a spender. I'll do a little Jeff Foxworthy. You just might be a spender if your mind's always thinking about the next vacation. Where am I going next? What am I doing next? It's going to be great. And you're planning, budgeting, and setting some. That might be a driving force. You might be a spender if you're thinking about upgrading all the time. Upgrading. You say, upgrading what? Everything. You know, upgrading this system, this toy, that toy, the newest, the biggest, the better. And if that drives you, you might be thinking like a spender. You might be a spender if you're always thinking about the next new experience. I got to go do this thing and experience this thing. I'll spend the money to go experience whatever it is I want to experience. If you're dreaming about the next best restaurant, the next best meal, the next thing you can get to make you enjoy life, that might be a hint that there's some spender in you. You might be a spender if you are continually adding to your collection. You say, collection of what? I don't know. You tell me. I knew a lady who had a collection of pictures, not like photographs or paintings, pictures that you pour like water or gravy, you know, pictures. And I was in her house one time, and this big hutch with shelves made of glass and these lights illuminating, I mean, just row after row of pictures. And I thought, she had a picture collection. I actually asked her, did you inherit that? No, those are all mine. I said, well, where'd you get those? And I kind of wanted to say, what's the deal with the pictures? Maybe you have a picture collection, I'm sorry, but I was just kind of like, I didn't understand it, right? Because she wasn't using them. They were just displayed, right? And I said, how did this get started? And she says, well, I hit a point years ago, this is what she said, I hit a point years ago where I realized I had everything I need. I had everything I need. And at Christmas and birthdays, people kept asking me, what can I get you? So I just came up with something. I said, well, get me a picture. And I started collecting them. So then people get me birthday and Christmas gifts that I don't need, apparently, but that I can put on my shelves and get a big hut. And I thought, you might be a spender if you have to come up with a collection of things so that people can get you something because you have everything. That might be a hint, right? You might be a spender if you're baffled by those people who save money. What's their deal, right? If you're like, why are you talking about saving? Just enjoy it. You only live once. I mean, you don't know if you're around tomorrow anyways. You might be a spender. So let God speak to you. Is that maybe part of it? That's where as a young Christian, that's where I started. I loved Jesus, but I didn't think much about more than just today and spending what came in. Meeting person number two. Here's another kind of person, the saver. So the spender. The spender says, live it up, and they're about today, but the saver is a different person. The saver says, I spend what I need today, and I'll give on occasion, but the most responsible way to handle money is to save, invest, and get ready for the future. And my motto is, add it up, man. Increase the retirement account, increase the savings, increase the stocks. My motto is, add it up. On three, say, add it up with me. 1, 2, 3, add it up. Okay, so the saver says, add it up, man. And more and more and more. And I'll use some to live on. And I might be generous a little bit, but really my focus is saving, 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 saving. And so this person, the saver, invests mostly in the future. The saver says, it's not about today. I'm fine for it. It's about getting ready for the future, whatever that means. And they're saving for the future. So Jesus spoke to somebody who's consumed with saving. Because here's the question. Is saving a good, responsible thing? What's the answer? Yes, of course it is. But if it's the driving force of your life, if it's the defining characteristic of your thinking, it will guide your life somewhere that's not exactly where God wants you to go. Because everything becomes about saving. So Jesus tells a story in Luke chapter 12. If you have your Bibles or your Bible app, you can go there to Luke 12, starting in verse 15. One of the 40% of the parables or stories of Jesus that's about material goods. So Luke 12, beginning of verse 15, we read this. Then Jesus said to them, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. And he told them this parable. Jesus told them this story. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. I mean, all of his storage bins were full. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll store my surplus grain. And I will say to myself, self, you have plenty of grain and laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God. A saver is all about saving. And their motto is add it up, add it up, add it up. And they're thinking not about today, they're thinking about the future. Now, there's nothing wrong with saving. There's nothing wrong with spending. But if spending rules our life and rules our thinking, we're going to be in trouble. If saving rules our life and rules our thinking, I think we're going to end up in trouble. This isn't where God is seeking to lead us. Now, how do I know? What are some of the hints or indicators that I might be in that saver category in my thinking? Well, you just might be a saver if your motto is the bigger the nest egg, the better. You can't make a nest egg. You can't make a nest too big or an egg too big for me. Always kind of. You might be a saver if you're always thinking about the next investment. I mean, I know I got this going and I got this going, but man, what if I added this and this? And there's always sort of the next thing that will get you to that place you want to be. You might be a saver if it's about more in my Roth, a next deal, a next property, a next step up. You might be a saver if you dream about the moment when you finally have enough saved to feel at peace. But for that person, it's always a dream because you never get there. I have a friend of mine who's a pastor. This pastor's in his 60s. His dad, so this pastor is in his 60s. His dad, who's still living, does not have enough to really feel comfortable. He has millions upon millions upon millions of dollars, but he doesn't have enough saved to feel in his own heart, to feel like he can go. His son is like 62 now, and he's in his 80s, but he doesn't have enough. And he's got more than I'll ever see in my life, and more than most of us will ever see. See, contentment's not about how much we have, it's about understanding who has us. It's a different thing. And so, you know, you might be a saver if you are baffled by those people who just get their money and just spend it. What is their deal? They spend everything they get. You don't understand the spender because you're a saver. And if a spender and saver are married to each other, come to last Saturday's conference on Cherish, right? Because there's things to learn, right? And then one more person, meeting person number three. This is the servant. I spend wisely today. I responsibly save for the future. But my driving passion is to invest money in things that honor and bless God, like his church, the broken and the needy, that which makes this world a better place, what God wants it to be. A servant is the one who says, all that I get, I want to use for the glory of God, and I want to invest in eternity. So the motto of this person is send it up. The motto of a servant is send it up. I want to invest in eternity. Send it upwards. On three, say, send it up with me. 1, 2, 3. Send it up. That's the motto of a servant. Invest in eternity. Send it up. And the servant invests mostly in eternity. The spender invests in today. The saver invests in their future. The servant invests in eternity. Pours into the things that last forever. And for a lot of people, they can't even imagine what that means. But listen to what Jesus says. In Matthew chapter 6, I read this at the beginning of the service, and I want to read it again. If you have your Bibles, you can look at Matthew 6, 19. Jesus says, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, send it on up, where moth and vermin do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. No one can serve two masters. Either they will hate the one and love the other, or they will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. This is Jesus speaking. This is the Sermon on the Mount. And he says, understand that there's ways to invest in eternity. And I believe what Jesus says, I think that Jesus teaches, it's good to spend and enjoy some of what you have. It's good to save and invest in the future with some of what you have. But the question is, what's the driving force of your life? And the driving force should be eternity. We have one life to live and eternity to spend with Jesus for all who put their faith in him. And so you might be a servant, and I would say for me, and my journey is early on as a Christian, I was really a spender. I started learning to be a saver. I'm trying to move towards the servant, where I understand that all I have is a gift from God and to be responsible with everything, to still spend wisely, to still invest in a way that honors Jesus and to prepare for the future, but to say that my primary driving force is, God, what do you want to do that impacts forever? Because that's what lasts forever. So you might be growing as a servant. You might be a servant or growing as a servant in your view of money if you notice needs as you go through your day and you respond. You see a need. You know something going, you're saying, can I help? Is there something I have that I can invest in that? You might be a servant when it comes to your material resources. If you take delight and joy in helping the church and helping Christian ministries and helping missionaries, helping ministries stay healthy to share the good news of Jesus, that's an indicator that you're growing as a servant. You might be a servant if you live with open hands and an open heart. Instead of saying, mine, 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 you say, God, you've been good. Whether I have a little or a lot, God, you've been good. And my hands are open and my heart's open to share, God, what you've put in my care. You might be a servant if your first response when you get some extra money is, how could I use this for the glory of God? And most of us go, huh? My first response when I get a little extra money, how can I use this? But if you're growing as a servant, that's the kind of thing that might come to your mind. You might be growing as a servant if you have a deep sense that all you have is a gift, that God is the giver of every good gift, and you've been truly blessed. You might be a servant if you have a sense that giving towards the things of God is an eternal investment. It's one of the best investments you could ever make. I have often said this. I have personally spent money on things and invested in things for me that I've regretted. That I've just thought afterwards, what was I thinking? That was just, come on, seriously, Kevin, right? I've never invested in the things of God. And later on said, what was I thinking? What a waste. Many of us have invested in investments that tanked. I've never invested in anything for Jesus that didn't bear fruit for the kingdom, because he promises it will. So it's a different way of thinking. And so I want you to look up on the screen here, because I want to kind of give you a picture of what this can look like. You know, so my take-home income, for somebody, it's a few hundred dollars. For somebody, it's thousands of dollars. For somebody, it's tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands. But all of this is across the boards. It's the same. You can be a generous person with a good view of money with very little money, and you can be a generous person with a good view of money with lots of money. And you can have a bad perspective with a little or a lot of money. And so what do I have? What does God provide for me in whatever means it is? What's my take home? What's the money I have available? And then I'm a steward. I'm a servant. It's all a gift from God. So what I do then is I say, okay, my spending, I can invest in the present. Do it responsibly. My savings, I can invest in the future. Do it prayerfully, thoughtfully, appropriately. And then my serving, I can invest in eternity. But what Jesus really teaches is one of those things is going to be the dominating way of our thinking. And Jesus' model is servant. Jesus, who left the glory of heaven with all the glory, all the power, all the authority to be born in a manger, served. Jesus, who took our sins on himself and paid the price, he served. In Mark 10:45, it says, Jesus Christ, the Son of Man, came not to be served, but to serve and to give himself as a ransom for many. That's our model, the model of a servant. And so I'm going to ask a couple of questions, and you'll see, you're a smart bunch of people here. You'll see right away where this is going, but I want you just to think through some different scenarios and what your first thought is or your first behavior is, okay? So when I was a child and received money, my normal response was, and here's three responses, and you're going to see, you'll figure out really quickly, it's spender, saver, servant, okay? My response was, buy a toy or something I wanted. Was that your response? My response was, put it in my piggy bank or my savings account. There were kids like that. Oh, extra money, piggy bank, savings account. That's the way they thought. Or give it to a friend or share it with a friend, the church, or someone in need. You know, different ways of thinking. Here's the second scenario. You hear about a couple in their 70s who lived a middle-class income, on a middle-class income the last 50 years, but through very careful savings and investment, they have a net worth of over $5 million. You hear that story, right? And there's three ways that you respond. Here's number one. What a waste. They should have spent it when they were young and could enjoy it. If that's your thinking, spender, right? Maybe this is your thinking. Wow, they did really well. I hope I can do the same. Saver. Or maybe your thinking is this. I wonder if they missed a lot of opportunities to invest in God's work in the world. That's a different way of thinking. One more. What does success look like? Success looks like, one, experiencing great food, travel, hosting friends, driving a nice car, and living in the right house. And that's success. Here's another view. Retiring at 50 and enjoying the fruit of my labors. I'm retired and just can enjoy life. Or here's the third option. Forgoing some luxuries, living below my means, so I can give faithfully to my church and help sponsor a missionary family. Give towards the work of the kingdom. Which of those would define how you think of success? I remember a couple in the very first church I served. I was a young pastor. I was in my 20s. And this couple, they had one child, but they both worked full-time for Brunswick Defense. She did high-tech stuff for space shuttles. This two-income family that did really well. They were very generous at the church. They served in the church. They were generous financially. Just great, committed Christian couple. And they invited Sherry and I over for dinner. And the first time I went to their home, I was shocked. It was clean, it was really well kept, but it was very, very small. I'll put it this way, as a 20-year-old young pastor, their home was much smaller than I thought it would be in light of what I knew they made in terms of money. And so while we were there, I'm looking around and I'm trying to put the pieces together. It didn't make sense to me. I was kind of a spender at the time. I didn't have a lot, but what I got, I'd spend. And I thought, well, God, they make all this money. And I didn't say anything to them because it wouldn't have been appropriate, but I got to know them over the next couple of months. And I was talking one-on-one with the husband. We became dear friends through the years. And I just said to him, I said, I got to ask you a question. And this is going to seem weird. And I'll tell you right now, it was probably inappropriate, okay? But I was young. Give me a break, right? But I'm in my 20s, and I said, so I just wonder. I said, you both work really hard, and you both make good incomes. And he said, oh, yeah, we do very, very well. And I said, your home is just so modest and so small. And what he said absolutely humbled me. He said, well, years ago, we realized that if we upgraded and went bigger, we couldn't give generously. So we just put a cap on our lifestyle and stayed where we were at. So then when needs come up, we can give towards all sorts of things. And that brings us the greatest joy. And I, as a young pastor, I was humbled because that wasn't how I thought. I mean, can I tell you, it wasn't just not how I thought. I couldn't comprehend that kind of thinking. And that taught me a ton. It taught me a lot. They were servants. That's the way. Not everyone has to live that way, but the mindset of saying, I want to send it up, man. I want to invest in eternity. And this couple invested in it. Not only did they serve with their stuff, they were the first couple to babysit our firstborn child, the first couple we dared to leave, when you're a new parent with a first child, and we handed them, but we so trusted them because they so loved Jesus. And so there's different ways to think and different ways to come at that. And we have to understand that my mindset absolutely establishes the trajectory of my life. So we should pray, God of every good gift, teach me to see money and things through your wise and beautiful eyes. God, let me see money, let me see stuff through your eyes, Lord. And so I want to invite you over this next week to do something. I want to invite you to really think and really pray. And I want to invite you to study yourself. Nobody else. And I'm not going to ask you next time. This is only a two-week series, but I'm not going to ask you next week. Okay, as this week as you prayed about it, just raise your hand if you're a spender. I'm not going to do that, okay? This is just for you and Jesus, right? But I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you just to, this week, watch yourself and say, in what ways am I a spender? In what ways am I a saver? In what ways am I a servant? And just begin to pray and say, God, I want to have the heart of a servant where I want to spend wisely. I want to save responsibly, but I want to serve and invest in eternity. And really pray about that. If you want to go deeper into this topic, we have two books in the bookstore. If you want to pick one of these up, and one is the God and Money book. And these are, again, two Harvard Business School students that wrote this as they were studying. And then Satisfied by Jeff Mannion, who comes and preaches once a year here. And he'll be here, I think, early next year to preach for us again, a book about contentment and being satisfied. I want to challenge you to humbly study your own life. And it doesn't matter if you're a college student and you get help from your folks and you're working part-time at Starbucks and you have very little. Or you've developed and sold multiple companies and you've got lots and lots of, it doesn't matter. The point is, what's my mindset? Because my mindset is going to shape my life. And that in any place of life, we all need to say, God, shape my life and my mind to be like Jesus. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for talking about stuff, about material goods, about money. And Lord, in our lives, it can be such a big thing, it can be such an important thing, but it can also be something that can get in the way of us really seeing what you want us to see and doing what you want us to do. So I pray, God, that this next week, we will study our own lives, we will be reflective and prayerful and humble, and I pray that you would begin to shape our thinking to be like the thinking of Jesus, so our lives will be like the life of Jesus. And eternity will never be the same because we've understood every part of our lives, including our material goods, from your perspective. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.